Hey guys, so this is going to be the next installment in my series for the shadow build 2.0. This part is involving the vignette. Now the tank that I used in the first part, the Asuka Sherman, that is sitting on a diorama already done and put away, and the reason I built that kit is to replace a model that had become kind of dated in its weathering features, and I wanted to update it with a replacement. For this part of the series, I've built a different tank, one that I've wanted to build for a while, and building it into a scene that I've wanted to build for a while. And this gives me the excuse to do it. So, this is going to be the Dragon's M4-105 howitzer tank that I've had in my stash for quite some time. This is basically the scene that it's going to be sitting in. Now, it's difficult to tell what that is, but I'll get to describing it in a few minutes. Now, before I go any further, though, this is a series on what a vignette is, not a diorama. A diorama is different than a vignette. Now, this is also going to be a series on what an actual vignette is, not a modeling contest version of what a vignette is. Different modeling contests have different definitions of what a vignette is classified as and what a diorama is classified as. And they're all different, right? Some of them have similar ones, some of them have slightly different ones, and there's too many of them for me to make videos about. And I don't build my work for modeling competitions. I build them because I build them. If they happen to fit into a criteria, then yay. If not, then well, I don't care. So if you want to build a vignette and you want it to be enterable into a competition, then you should really look up what the competition requires and what they define a vignette is, because they're usually pretty specific about it. But it's not going to be the same what a real vignette would be. There's a big difference between what a diorama and a vignette is, but there's also an extreme number of similarities between them. There's a lot of things that are misleading. People kind of confuse them a lot of the time. For example, there's no size limitation to a vignette, then just like there's no size limitation to a diorama. A diorama could be very, very small, it could be very, very large. And a vignette can be enormous, and it can also be small. Size is not a limiting factor to a vignette or a diorama. The defining feature between a vignette and a diorama is a diorama tells a story. That's the major function of a diorama. It's a story with oftentimes it has smaller sub-stories being told within it. And that's basically what a diorama is. A vignette would be one of those sub-stories. It would be a snapshot in time. That's all a vignette is in the modeling world. In all kinds of other aspects of the world, it means many different things. But in the modeling world, all it is a snapshot in time. It can be as complicated as it needs to be, and it can be as simplistic as it needs to be. It can be just a tank sitting on a hill with grass. It could be a tank with trees and a couple of guys standing around with a Jeep in front of it, but there's no actual story going on. It's just a bunch of guys standing around. It just looks like someone took a picture of it. You can't actually tell if anyone's doing anything. Right, it's just literally a snapshot in time. It's something small, and it's something simple in its focus. Not something small in size, something simple in its focus. So you could have 8 Sherman tanks driving up a hill. That's it. That would be a vignette, because it's very, very simple. There's no major story element or anything going on there. But if you have 8 Sherman tanks going up a hill, and on the other side there's a bunch of Tiger tanks going on, and you have a bunch of infantry following the Sherman tanks, well, then you've created a diorama, because now there's a story element, right? You can actually see something happening there, right? A bunch of Shermans climbing a hill it just looks like someone took a picture of a bunch of Shermans climbing a hill. That's the difference between diorama and vignette. One is complicated, one is simple. In its story, one has one, one doesn't. That's really it. And that's why it makes it difficult to judge them at competitions, because oftentimes a vignette can be very, very elaborate with garages and street lights and curbs and stuff like that, and just have a tank sitting on it, where it's just a snapshot of a tank sitting on a street. That is a vignette. But yet, it also, according to modeling competitions, that can be fallen into the diorama category, because it has elaborate scenic elements to it, because that's what they demand for dioramas. And that's not actually what a real diorama is. So, my focus is going to be on what a vignette is. So, what you see in front of you is basically a Sherman tank that's climbing up. It's going to be a road embankment. It's basically using a road embankment to gather elevation, because it's a 105 howitzer. It's an artillery vehicle, an infantry support weapon. So it's using the reverse side of a road embankment to gather increased elevation so it can fire artillery rounds more successfully. And it's basically sitting on the hill, and it's just sitting there, or it's just moving. You can't really tell. You won't be able to tell from the scene. So it'll probably have a road, it'll probably have a couple of telegraph poles or lampposts or power lines, depending on what part of the world you come from. It all depends on what you call them. Maybe a fence and some grass and maybe a culvert. I don't really know yet. I haven't completely fussed it out yet. This is just the general layout. The difference between this and what a diorama is, and I'll show you what a diorama is. This would be a diorama. This is my Holland Boys diorama that I built a couple years ago, I think. A year ago, maybe 2 years ago. This is qualified as a diorama. There's multiple stories going on in an overall story arc. The story arc is recovering vehicles. That's the story arc. A bunch of guys recovering vehicles. And it also conveys the traffic heavy... the traffic issues that was happening in Normandy during the just after the landings. There was a lot of traffic jams. So that was basically what I was trying to convey. But in that, I also included a bunch of smaller sub-stories. One sub-story would be the MP standing around the Jeep here having drinks and eating apples that had fallen off the apple tree over here. That would be, if you took that out of this context, it would be just a vignette. The Diamond T that's driving along here, if I took that out and set it all by itself on like just a grassy road, that would be a vignette. If I put it in here, it becomes a story element. I mean, there's actually a story in there. Two guys are driving along while one guy's reading a Tamiya modeling magazine. The Panzer IV that's sitting here has got a booby trap sign on it, and there's two guys over here trying to figure out how to disarm the booby traps. They're trying to explore the booby traps. That in itself, if I took it out of context, could be a vignette. But not really, because there's a bit of a story element on that. It could be a bit of a diorama as well, because you can actually see guys doing stuff. The two fellows that are over here, they're kind of just carrying on, you know, possibly maybe a little bit drunk, eating apples that have fallen off the apple tree, right? Those two guys standing by themselves, that could be just a vignette, right? You include them in with the scene with the Panzer IV, it becomes a diorama. Right. The dragon wagon being hauled along all by itself, you take that and just put it on a piece of wood, it's just a vignette. You take it and put it in here, it becomes a diorama, because this tanker here is talking to the MP, and the MP is part of the booby trap scene. So that carries over and it just develops into a larger story arc. So that's basically what a diorama is. It's one large story with smaller little stories involved, and you can view the scene from multiple directions, like several directions. You can spin this thing around, and you have a more of a three-dimensional aspect to it. Whereas a vignette, normally it's only one direction, maybe two, that you can look at it from. It's meant to have a single focus point. It doesn't always have to be that way, but that's the general consensus when it comes to vignettes. So when it comes to the planning, it's really, that's what you're thinking about when you're planning it. This here is also a vignette. It sells a single focal point, snapshot in time. It's a very simple scene, yet it's also not small. It's kind of large, and it does have some elaborate nature to it. There's blasted trees, there's a trench, there's a machine gun abandoned, some craters blown in there, but the focus is the tank. It's the single focus. Now, this one's a little bit atypical. You can spin it around and look at it from multiple viewpoints, but that is, you know, just a little bit atypical for most vignettes. But it's still a vignette because it's a single snapshot in time. It's a very, very simple scene, and there's no figures or anything like that. Now, I could add a figure to it if I wanted to, and it would still be a vignette, but if I started adding figures that were relating to each other, then it starts developing the story element to it, the story nature to it, and you start crossing the line into diorama. Now, this one here, pretty much, well, in some aspects it does cross the line into diorama, in others it doesn't. It's a very, very simple scene. It doesn't have any terrain features other than a grass mat, and then the vehicle itself. And it's literally a tiger crew looking for directions, and that's it. That implies a story element, which means it could cross the line into diorama. Not the number of figures or anything, that has nothing to do with it. It's because the figures are interacting with each other in a very discernible way. It starts telling a story, and it's no longer really a snapshot in time. But because the story element is so simple, it could still be just a snapshot in time. So there are some vague lines in the sand when it comes to diorama vignette. Sometimes it's very easy to tell the difference between a diorama and a vignette. Like my Holland Boys diorama, that's very obviously a diorama. Where this one here, it's a little bit more of a vague discernation. It's, you have to hum and haw about it a bit. Myself, I would say that's a vignette because it doesn't tell a very complicated story. The story is extremely simple. Where this one is definitely a diorama. There's definitely story elements. There's more than one story element going on. And it has slightly more complicated terrain features involved. Now, terrain features aren't necessarily a disqualifier for vignettes. Terrain features can be very complicated in vignettes. If they're part of the scene, and it's still a single snapshot in time, it's still very much a vignette. What you're looking for when you're really trying to decide if it's a vignette or not is if it just tells one aspect, one story, and it's very simple, and it's identifiable right away. Right away, that there's just one thing going on, right? If that's evident, it's a good chance it's probably a vignette. So it doesn't matter what size it is or anything or how complicated it is, that's probably what it is. Now, according to modeling competition rules, they have a very different idea of that. This is definitely qualified as a diorama according to their rules, where the tiger I just showed you is definitely also qualified as a diorama because there's more than two or three figures on there, right? And that's not exactly true. The number of figures in some competitions is a defining rule. The number of terrain features is also a limiting factor for vignettes and stuff like that. But this is definitely qualified as a diorama, according to their rules, and mine as well. I would call this definitely a diorama. So, anyway, so because of the simplistic value of the story for this scene, it would classify as a vignette in my interpretation of what a vignette would be. There's a single story element, and the story element is not exactly discernible right away. And if you can discern it, it's just the one element. There's no other elements going on. It's literally a Sherman parked on a hillside. That's it. There's nothing else going on. Like I said, there'll be a roadway at the top, maybe a telegraph pole here, and a fence that is here that the tank may have knocked down as it traveled through. I may put the fence back here, I'm not sure. I may have a small water feature coming through here where it traveled through it. I'm not entirely sure at this moment. This is the generalized scene that I wanted to portray. Now, when it comes to vignettes, planning is important because you want to avoid the things I just described, the things that tell too much of a story. You want to keep it simple. You want to singular focus, you know, try and keep the viewpoints down to a minimum. Mine will probably have multiple viewpoints, unfortunately, unless I put up some kind of like a retaining wall or something along here that's, you know, blocking view and stuff like that. I may actually do that to keep it within the teaching value of this video purposes. I may actually end up doing that. So there might end up being a small retaining wall here, so that you wouldn't look at the diorama from the backside. You would only look at it, or not the diorama, the vignette. You wouldn't look at the vignette from this side. You would only look at it from this side, or maybe from the two corners. So you would have a definable back to the scene. Now that's not critical to a vignette, but it is something that kind of defines them, that it is a singular viewpoint, or a wider viewpoint than a diorama. Dioramas have a very wide viewpoint, and vignettes very narrow focus. So you're keeping it to so that you're just looking at it, you know, within the narrow parameters of the frame there, then, you know, I've done what I wanted to do. So now, this is a scene that I had in my head for a long, long time. It was actually inspired by another modeler that, actually, I'll show you the work. Now, his name is James Weschler. He's a very fine modeler who does a lot of Sherman tank builds. And that's the model that inspired me to do this. Now, that's an Easy 8 version of the 105. It has the HVSS suspension rather than the VSS. Vertical volute. Vertical volute suspension system. His scene is going to be very different than mine, but it gave me the idea of where I wanted to go. Having the 105 sitting like that on an angle to gaining extra elevation, that's what inspired me. That's where I wanted to go. Mine's going to have more elevation, and mine's not going to have the water feature he had on his. Mine might have a culvert, like a drain, on the side, because I wanted to try and make one. I saw Hamilcar Barkas put one in on his Famorama diorama that he's working on now, this epic build that he's finishing. And I like the way he did that, and it kind of inspired me to give it a try. So I might have something like that coming out from just on the side of the Sherman, somewhere over here, maybe. Just a small one there. Draining out so there's like a small creek or something like that coming out. Just to give a little bit of visual interest to the scene. More like a farmer's field and kind of idea. And the Sherman is climbing up onto the bank to deliver whatever it is going to deliver. So, again, you know, keeping the scene simple, you can have complicated story, like scenic elements, but the story element you want to keep simple. So, that's about it. So, now what I'm going to do with this now, the tank itself is built. I mean, there's nothing else I want to do. It's just needs to be painted. And it'll probably take me about a week or so to paint that. The figures are already done. They just need to be popped out and painted as well. The base, none of these are glued down. So this foam that's on here, it's basically just bits and pieces of garbage that I had lying around from other builds. And this base is actually a puzzle that my kids no longer play with. And so I'm reusing it. So it's just a piece of plywood. And so these will all get glued down with some carpenter's glue, wood glue. And then I'll wait for that to dry for a day. And then I'll start coating it with some cellulite to give it some shape. And get it in the general layout that I want it to do. So that'll be the next video. I'll film me, you know, gluing it down, and then I'll apply the cellulite clay and sculpt it a bit. And then, of course, then there'll be a delay because I have to wait, you know, 3 to 5 days for it to dry, and then I can start working on the terrain features. So that'll be next. Okay, so the first thing I want to do is glue this foam down on the base so that I have something to work with. I don't want to forget where I had all that. Kind of annoying. So the glue I use is this stuff here. It's what's available here in Canada, but it's basically it's wood glue, contractor's carpenter glue. It's very, very tough, dries yellow. So it's, you know, you got to be careful where you use it on a diorama because it'll dry and still be visible. And I'll use a liberal amount of it because I want to make sure that this foam isn't going to lift after I apply it. So I spread it on using an artist's palette knife. I find a palette knife is an extremely useful tool when it comes to diorama work and vignette work and stuff like that for scenics. I use it quite a bit, actually. And they're cheap, really cheap, like a dollar. That's all this thing cost me. It was a buck. And I've had it for years and years and years. I actually have a couple of them, but I really only use the one. All right, so I'll spread this on the areas where I want to put the foam. You don't want it to overhang, so you want it to be as neat as you can. If you can manage it. Alright. Now, let's see. How did I put you there? I'll put you there. That'll be the first layer, I think. This glue dries in about 20 minutes, but when it's sealed up like this, like layered inside of stuff, it takes longer. So I usually let it sit for 8 to 10 hours before I do anything to it. Otherwise, it just lifts up while I'm working, and it's a pain in the butt. And because I'm laminating it as well like this, I'll also not touch it for a while. If you really wanted to be picky, you would add each layer. You'd add one layer, let it dry, add another layer, let it dry. But I have no patience for stuff like that, so I don't. So you more patient and diligent modelers would do that. That's not me. I'm definitely not patient, and I'm certainly not diligent. So these are just bits of garbage and leftover dioramas. I usually keep bits and pieces like this so that I can use them for flushing out scenes like that. That'll probably do. I think I might get another. Another piece and stick it there. Another piece in there. I do. Oop, sorry about that, fellas. The camera stand is a bit large. It gets in the way sometimes. I wonder why I'm sticking these little pieces in here. It's because I'm just filling in some of the voids so that when I add cellulose, I don't have these little pockets of thick stuff. A little bit here and there is not going to hurt anything. So I don't want a ton of it. That'll probably do. Something along those lines. So there'll be a, like I said, a road here. And then I'm probably going to have that retaining wall here. And possibly maybe a culvert area down here. Let me actually turn these on the other side. Like that. So if I want to put the culvert, I'll put it there. If. I haven't decided if I want to do that yet. I think it would look neat having a culvert draining out from under the road, flowing that way across there, and then the tank sitting parallel to it. So, and again, when you're planning scenes like this, things you want to avoid parallel lines. So you don't want your tank sitting this way. You don't want it to follow the lines of the frame, right? You don't want your road to follow the lines of the frame, right? You don't want, if you're going to put a retaining wall on, don't let it follow the lines of the frame either. Have everything on a slight angle. So my road is going to go here in this direction. It'll kitty corner this part of the diorama. It'll either go right to the edge, or it'll come to the edge and there'll be a little grassy bit on the corner to show the edge of the road there. The retaining wall will be possibly here, but it might also be a fence. I'm not sure yet. It'll also be on a slight angle. It'll be perpendicular to the road, not perpendicular to the frame. The culvert, also the drain, will be perpendicular to the road, not perpendicular to the frame. And the tank itself will also be in the center of the diorama and on an angle. And if I put any trees or anything like that, which I don't think I'm going to, it might be a small shrub or bush, none of them will be in equal corners, so there won't be a bush here, a bush here, a bush here, a bush here. Won't be four cornering, any four cornering going on or anything. There might be a lamppost here, or telephone pole, telegraph pole, depending on what you call them, where you're from. And that's it. So it'll be a fairly simple scene. Not a whole lot of foliage, it'll be mostly grass, and it'll be a summer, late summer scene, so it'll be all lots of green. So that's my plan. Now I gotta let that dry, probably, like I said, 10 hours or so, and then I'll come back to it and do some more work on it. Okay, so this thing's dry now. It's only been about maybe 6 hours, and I'm gonna start working on the cellulose clay part of it now. So the cellulose clay is going to go over pretty much everything you see that's not covered in green tape. Now I taped off the edges because I want to be able to paint them black when I'm done. And it also keeps any cellulose clay from getting stuck to it and stuff like that. I can scrape it off easily enough once it's on. So this is my cellulose clay bucket. It's what I've been using for years to make cellulose clay in. This is cellulose clay. I don't know if I've ever actually mixed this on camera before. I think I did a long time ago. So this is cellulose clay. It's basically finely ground paper mache is what it is. And I need enough in order to cover this thing. And I usually just guesstimate it. That's what it looks like there. It's very dusty. Makes lots of mess. Until you get it wet, then it doesn't anymore. Alright. So it's basically, like I said, it's paper. Very fine, finely ground white paper, mixed with PVA glue and plaster. That's pretty much what it is. Then I add enough water to make it look like oatmeal. I don't add it all at once. I add it a bit at a time. because if you add it all at once, there's a good chance you're going to add too much. Usually I have the extractor fan on for this because it makes so much dust. And it gets all over the models on the shelves behind me. The water I'm using is just, you can use just tap water if you want. I generally, for all water needs I use for modeling, I tend to use RO water, reverse osmosis water. I have an RO device in my house, so I can just produce RO water whenever I need to. RO water is extremely clean, so it's reduced in contaminants, so there's less chance of weird things happening while you're working. Okay, that's pretty much all you want. It's pretty much like oatmeal. Don't eat it. It won't hurt you. It's just gross. You don't want to eat it. It's really not a pleasant thing to put in your mouth. The reason why I use cellulose so much is because it's very, very cheap and it goes very, very far. I've made 8 to 10 very large dioramas with this one bag, and this bag cost me $30, and I had a 50% off coupon when I bought it. So, and this bag was, when I first bought it, was full right up to here. It was huge, so right up to the top. It's a 5-pound bag, 2.27 kilograms, and it goes a very long way. So now that I have that mixed up, the next thing I do is I usually add some color to it. So I use this cheapo acrylic paint that I buy at my local craft store, which is also where I get the cellulose from. And so I mix a little bit of this brown. It says burnt umber, but it's actually more like raw umber than anything else. It's like this tan color. Burnt umber is a dark, dark brown, and raw umber is more of a reddish brown. I don't know why they do that, but that's okay. So I mix the two of these together, and I put it in here. Because the cellulose clay is stark white, I try to get rid of that color as much as I can, because it pokes through. If you don't, you're going to poke it through. What I mean by the red, that's not burnt umber, that's raw umber. It's actually even closer to sienna, burnt sienna. Okay, that should be all I'm going to need for that. I mix the two of them together. This is a little wetter than I normally do. I usually use the paint as part of the water content, but it just means it's going to take longer to dry. That's all it means. You can use a machine to do this if you got one. The machine's probably going to take a shit kicking doing this, but to use the spoon, doesn't really matter. It works just the same. Nice brown color, that's what I was going for. Incidentally, if I put this on here and then just spray it with Future a couple of times after it's dried, it takes a glossy color and looks just like mud. It's a very easy, fast way to make mud. So now that I got my cellulose clay mixed, I can leave this in this container with a cover on it for, probably 8 to 10 days. It won't dry. It'll start drying out. It'll get less moist. If I let it go too long, like 3 or 4 weeks, it will start to smell. Cut a little bit. Actually, it'll start to smell a little bit like vomit. So you may want to avoid that. because once it starts to smell like that, if you use it on a diorama, your diorama is always going to have a slight vomit smell to it. So if you don't want that kind of thing, best not to do that. So use your cellulose clay within a week once you make it up, and make sure that the container you have it in is nice and airtight. Otherwise, it will dry out really quick. So I need to put some glue on the base in order to ensure maximum retention. This is just regular craft glue, white purpose, or all-purpose PVA. Where's my brush? I have a brush here that I use for this. And so I take water, and I mix it into the brush, and just smear this stuff all over. I don't use the palette knife for this because it doesn't get in all the nooks and crannies as well. Everywhere. Little pieces come loose, it's no big deal because I'm using glue to tack it back down. It's not going to move anyway once I get the cellulose clay on. And it's mostly intended to be filler. But it is really annoying if you do this when it's when all this these parts are still wet. So it's that's why I glue it down first. If a couple little pieces break off, it's no big deal. Now, the reason I'm doing this is because I don't have any plaster bandages. If I had plaster bandages, I wouldn't be doing this. I would, I would do this, but then I'd overcoat this whole thing with plaster bandage. Another thing that you can do if you really want to, it's something I've done once or twice. It works. It does add extra strength. And that's, once you get all the glue on like this, you take sheets of paper towel or just regular like printer paper or tissue paper, and you lay it on over top like you would plaster bandage, and then you spray it once it's on and it's in the position you want. You spray it with thinned PVA glue and you let it dry for a few hours, and it should get hard. And once it's hard, it's very similar to a plaster bandage. It's not as strong though. It'll never be as strong as plaster bandage would be, but it does give a pre-form that you can lay cellulose clay on. But as soon as you put the cellulose clay on, it reactivates, well, softens the PVA, and you lose a bit of that shape a bit. It differs from using the plaster bandage. The plaster bandage doesn't do that. The plaster bandage is quite tough. Alright, so you don't have to be in any particular hurry to do this. Like I said, the cellulose clay is good for quite some time, sitting by itself. Usually use the little palette knife as an applicator because it's flexible. It's got a narrow end on it, so it helps me with carving certain structures, and I can get in the nooks and crannies and stuff if I need to. And as you can see, it spreads quite easily, kind of a little bit like spreading oatmeal on something or cake batter. It's more like cake batter right now because it's a little bit too thin, but normally it's a little bit thicker, but only a little bit. As I said, because it's as moist as it is now, the only difference between the way it is now and the way I normally do it is it'll dry slower. It'll take probably 10 days to dry rather than 5. Now, one thing you want to try to stick to when you're working with cellular clay is try not to make the layers that you're putting on any deeper than 1 centimeter, if you can avoid it. Cellular clay, when it dries, it will shrink, and if it's any thicker than 1 centimeter, it has quite a bit of strength in its pull. So yeah, for certain bases, especially like plywood and stuff, it'll bend it quite significantly. I've had it fold 1.5 inch thick MDF board, like a large piece of it too, like 2 feet by 1.5 feet size, and it gave it this very distinctive banana boat shape over the course of a couple of months as the cellular clay dried. And that's because I put it on too thick and then didn't clamp it down. Just getting the general shape. Probably gonna have to make some more, I think. I probably should have made twice as much as I have. The surface area, while all its nooks and crannies in here, is taking up a lot more than the cellular clay than I expected. I usually end up having like 2 batches anyway. No matter how big the batches I make, I usually end up always having to make 2. It's a product of my spatial acuity, I guess. Making a cake. Really ugly, shit-colored cake. Again, don't eat it. That's right, I am proud of it too. I find crazy people make the most interesting people. Yeah, normal people are boring. So t-shirts made up, loony and proud. Okay, so I'm just going to whip up another batch. Okay, that's the second batch made up now. This one's a little thicker than the previous one, only slightly, but it's more in the consistency where I want it. It's good for when I do the sides. I want it a little bit thicker because it'll stick better. So, it'll help me that way. A lot like poo, doesn't it? In case you're wondering, it doesn't smell like poo. It doesn't smell like anything, actually. It smells like dust. Paper. Like sawdust. And generally, I'm going to try to make the surface as smooth as I can. And then once I get it smooth, I have an idea of what the surface is going to look like contour-wise. Then I can shape it, adding more and more cellulose clay to the areas that I want. Add thickness to and more shape to. And if I want to add more layers to hide any of the substrate, like hide some of the styrofoam that's underneath, I can do that. But once I get the contours in, I know pretty much where I'm at, where I stand for shape. But you got to keep an eye on how thick it's getting, though. It's a little bit thick in here in the hillside, but that's okay, because where it's at there, as it dries, it's not going to bend anything. Like, it won't bend the base at all, because there's not enough of it there. I've done that before, so that's why I know. Sides. Do the sides so it looks a little bit more like a soddy, like the seam is cut from the earth, sort of thing. And it also neatens up the edges. You can eliminate having to do this by putting a frame around it if you want, or you can cut some foam board and block out the back altogether using some foam board or balsa wood if you can. Get some. Balsa wood's pretty expensive around here, and so I don't tend to use very much of it. It's probably the most expensive building material I would use, so I tend not to use much in the way of balsa wood. There's very cheap, it's like craft wood basically. It's the same stuff that popsicle sticks and like coffee stir sticks are made out of. Around here anyway, it's just like a really cheap pine softwood, and I use that more than anything else, and I find it just as workable as balsa for what I use it for anyway. As you can tell, I'm not a cake decorator. The birthday cakes that I make for my kids are something that is also used at Halloween to scare the neighbors. So it's not really a skill that I've become good at. I'm also not a wall finisher. I do a whole lot of crack filling around the house. Well, I do a little, but not the same thing. A little double entendre there. It's a bad joke. Alright, so once I get this done, will be in a second here. I let it sit for a few hours, and then I add some of the texture sands and particles that I add to the surface. So if I'm going to be doing a road surface, which is what I'm going to be doing in this, and I want it to be gravel, right, I'll add the gravel in, well, not long after this. And once it's on, it kind of bonds itself into the surface of the vignette. Because there's, like I said, there's glue mixed in with the cellulose clay, and the paint is also a form of adhesive. It's not a very good one, but it also acts as a bonding agent as well. So anything that I throw on top of this while it's wet, there's a pretty good chance it's going to stick there, unless it's really heavy. So, but I'll put on several layers of rocks and sands and some pieces of pulverized bark mulch and other assorted scatter and stuff, and let it all kind of harden together over a few days. And then when it's done, I'll tip it on its side, and any of the loose stuff that didn't glue just falls off. And then I can spray the surface with a little bit of thinned PVA and just stick them back on if I want to. Corners are always a pain. So that's the general shape of the hillside that I'm working on now. And the road is pretty much, where's the corner? There it is. The road is going to go right here. It's just a thin farmer's road. But this kind of road isn't going to be like a standard, like French highway road or anything like that. It's sort of be like all, like, what do you call it? Manufactured gravel or anything. It's more like a farmer's road. So it'll have like a wagon trail type thing. So that's what I'm going for. I'm going to give it a bit of a bank here. And this is going to get covered in grass. Give it one on the other side. Now, a lot of guys, they'll do this with DAS modeling clay, the DAS air dry clay. And you can. There's no reason why you can't do that. I have plenty of it here, thanks to a friend of mine who sends me all kinds of it for a very economical price. The reason why I don't do it is because I prefer the texture of the cellulose clay. It looks very much like earth, and without it actually being earth. So I tend to prefer it over the DAS. The DAS I would have to add cellulose clay over. Or I'd have to add an earth texture to it in some fashion by like actually using real earth, real dirt, or something similar to it in order to give it the texture that earth actually has. So I just go straight to the meat of the matter and go with the cellulose clay. Alright. So now we have a rise on the side there, which is what I want. And I want a small one in the middle for the, go in between the ruts. Now these little features that I'm adding are much deeper than the 1 centimeter allowance that I usually go with for cellulose clay. But that's fine because these are just sculpted features. They're probably not going to be a problem. I do this quite often, and it's never been an issue before. I don't expect this to be. So, like I said, I do this a lot where I do sculpted features like this. And they do sometimes take a little bit longer to dry, but modeling is supposed to be an exercise in patience, they say. So it's something that I am desperately in need of, is some patience. So it won't hurt me at all to do this. All right, that's basically the shape that I want there. Now, I wanted a culvert under the road. I'm going to put it here. So we're going to put the culvert here. This is basically a small stream that's used to drain the road. And I'll actually add water to this. Once this is all dry. I get asked today what I seal this with, if I'm going to use water. With cellulite clay, generally I don't seal it with anything. Unless it's going to be a lot. If it's just going to be a little tiny bit, like for this for example, then I won't add anything. When I pour the water, if I'm using Woodland Scenic's realistic water, I'll pour a little bit in there, and then take a paintbrush and pull it up to the sides to where I want the water to be, the highest point of the water, and then let it dry, and it acts like a seal, right? And then I wait for that to dry, and then I'll pour my water in that. And that's basically what I do. Now, if I'm going to be doing like a deep water feature, like I did on my Hurtgen Forest diorama, if I'm going to be doing that, I'll make, under the cellulite clay, I'll have a trough of tin foil, aluminum foil, to keep the anything that leaks through from flowing out and coming out from under the sides. If I dug a big hole in this and I poured and waited for this to dry and I poured like easy water or I poured Woodland Scenic's water into the middle of it, it will literally find its way down through the bottom and start leaking out through the sides under the cellulite clay. The stuff is very penetrating. It's very thick, but you'd be surprised how far it's spreads and how far it'll like work its way through cracks and nooks and stuff like that. It's quite insinuating, the stuff is. So you gotta make sure that you don't have any holes or anything underneath that you don't want it to go in. But again, when I do something small like this, I'll literally just pour a little bit in there and then drag it up with a small brush so it acts like a paint almost. And it's very thin, it's only like a millimeter thin, so it's not gonna soak into anything or flow anywhere. And then I'll add my water over that. Okay, now I also want to add a retaining wall here, but I don't know what I'm going to use yet for that wall. So I'm going to put a furrow in here. I have an idea what I'm going to use, but I don't know if it's going to be big enough yet. We'll see. So I'll put that there, and if it's too big, I can fill it in because I have excess cellulite clay. Okay, and this is just going to be sculpted with rocks. I'll have little pebbles, beach pebbles surrounding it. Should be a pretty good start to it there. Alright. Now, I'm going to let this sit for about 5 hours, and then I'll come back and do the next part, which is I add the texture materials, and then imprint the vehicle marks. So that'll be the next bit. Actually, that'll be in the next video, because this one's already getting a little long. So I'll see you in the next part. You guys be good. Keep your stick on the ice. Bye for now.